if you look at these frameworks just being implemented for decades altogether, maybe for centuries altogether, what you will find missing is that soul development is nowhere in their agenda, both the Abrahamics as such, you know, I mean, Abrahamic ideas, Abrahamic thought processes. Hence, that is why they almost reject the idea of reincarnation, because it doesn't fit their agenda. Namaskar, everybody. Reincarnation in the mainstream discourse and its likely impact on Abrahamic ideas, Abrahamic religions. And before I begin this talk, let me give you a brief glimpse of how the talk is going to be. It is going to talk about the research in the area of reincarnation as such, and how it indicates that it is almost a scientific process, scientific in nature, with a clear cause and effect relationships. And how is this likely to become a mainstream subject of discourse? We will discuss three kinds of typologies: typology of discourse, typology of knowledge, and typology of disagreements, because that is what will decide what happens with the awareness about reincarnation, and how the faith or the belief systems which don't accept it right now, how are they going to respond to it. As I begin, I would like to dedicate this talk to Dr. Jay Lakhani, the founder of late Dr. Jay Lakhani, the founder director of the Hindu Academy, London. Originally, he was to deliver a talk on Sangam platform on a topic like this. And it was unfortunate that around the time when the discussions were going on, he proceeded with his heavenly abode. By and large, I would like to begin with what Dr. Jay Lakhani himself had to say about the three worldviews about reincarnation, the multiple lives, as we can say so. The first view which he has outlined, and I have the YouTube link with me, which is the source of this particular three worldviews that I'm giving. First worldview is that, friend, there is only one life, and make most out of it. Don't bother about too many lives. And the perspective or the counterpoint or one of the aspect of this worldview is that it is, you know, it is quite fine so long as living one life with, you know, I mean, the fullest of joy and fullest of meaningfulness is concerned. And it is quite pragmatic in nature. You know, I mean, it doesn't really get entangled into spirituality or religion or the science aspect of the life. You know, it believes in enjoying the life as such. The second worldview is Abrahamic view, which says that it is one life, dear friend, and you need to become a devout Christian or devout Muslim. But the point in the process, the counterpoint is that one could become very rigidized minds. The third view, third worldview that we have is that there are infinite number of lives we had earlier and we will be having in future. So this is the worldview, which is based on reincarnation, a number of lives, and most probably the Brahmic view. But the point here, again, Dr. Jay Lakhani points out that the drawback with this worldview is that one may have a easy going, laid back and lazy attitude towards life, that, you know, I mean, why to bother about your own growth, your own inner progress? You have so many of them, so many of lives coming in. So why to bother about your own progress? So one may end up wasting the life that you have. To begin with, the reincarnation, first question people ask is about the proofs. And, you know, on certain things, what we need to understand is that convincing others, presenting proof to support whatever you're trying to establish is something which may be required in certain cases. In certain cases, it may not be required. If you're holding a pencil on your hand, you won't need to prove that it is a pencil. Of course, in certain other cases, you may need to do certain research and you need to have certain statistical support. For example, suppose if I want to say that 3% people in Delhi speak Tamil, then in that case, because there is nothing visible as such, you know, it's a statement, it's a hypothesis. In that case, I may really need to do a survey, and based on the data analysis, I'll be able to prove my point through visible tabulation and graphs and pie charts that it is 3% of people in Delhi who speak Tamil too. So certain cases, visible proof is required. Certain cases, things are, self-explanatory. And all the more, in certain cases, we don't really need to present proof and give, a detailed explanation if the two people who are engaging in conversation are on same page or on same level. So talking about reincarnation, yes, certain people may ask for proof, but there will be another set of people who wouldn't really need proof because they are on same page. That is what gets us to the typology of knowledge. Typology of knowledge. You see, there are two kinds of knowledge. One is the knowledge, as we can call, verbalized knowledge. Verbalized knowledge, most of the science comes under this category, where everything that you know has been documented, and it has gone through certain series of experiments and observations and validation, and it has been found to be, repeating itself over and over, again and again, in different geographical locations, different time framework. So that is what comes under the verbalized knowledge. Verbal basically means the use of words. Certain places need of documentation. So most of science comes under this category. And second category of knowledge is what we can call intuitive knowledge, where the words are not really involved as such. The ant knows when to pick up, sugar particle, but not to pick up a wooden particle and things like that. The deer knows how to, the sunflower knows how to bend towards sun. So, forget the nature. Even the child knows intuitively who is mother and who is father and who is sister and who is brother and things like that. So point here is that, between these two knowledge, we tend to give more weightage to verbalized knowledge because of the formal education system that we are all conditioned in. Intuitive knowledge is not really considered as knowledge as such. It's basically considered as something else altogether. Maybe it is considered as characteristics or, social process, more or less. But if you say intelligent people of two kind, one is academic intelligent and the other is the worldly intelligent people, like we call it street smart people, they are the ones who place equal weightage also to intuitive knowledge, So with this as one of the cornerstones, in the whole thought process, we will proceed towards what we are trying to discuss, the theme of reincarnation. Before we get into the reincarnation, let us also see the typology of mainstream discourse, because we are talking about if and when the discussion about the reincarnation becomes mainstream, then what is likely to happen. So in that context, it is important to understand what are the various types of mainstream discourse also. The two kinds of mainstream discourses are, one is what you can call arguments and debates, where there are two sides and there are points and counterpoints, and there is either acceptance or rejection. And because there are two separate sides, it is mostly, the two parties engaged with each other, they are trying to continuously or perpetually reject each other's thought process. And the audience is either supporting by accepting one side or rejecting the other side. So it is the people who are engaged in the mainstream discourse and the audience or the followers or the crowd, as we can call it. So the behavior is built around building up points and counterpoints and supporting each other, rejecting each other, and the crowd and the audience accepting the side that they are favoring. And I put the gravity as an image, because we should be able to recall what happened when the gravity was under a big question mark in our society around 700, 800 or 900 years ago. There was a scientist who had to be in prison and he had to drink poison because he recommended something that was against church. The second kind of discourse is what we can call developmental and collaborative. Usually it happens behind the closed doors, in the meetings, in the collaborative deals. where what they're trying to do is they're trying to mobilize whatever is known for a meaningful or useful project or work. So mutually accepted concept is being converted to a useful project, useful work. And that is, the second kind of discourse, as you can call it. So having seen the typology of knowledge and typology of discourse, let us now move to the case of the next keyword, which is cause-effect patterns. Cause-effect pattern basically means that one thing triggers second thing, and second thing is the result of the first thing, but it triggers. It's the second point is the cause of the third point. And I have taken a very simple, incident which could occur in any home, that there is a child who is alone in home, maybe 13, 14 years of age. Mother has gone shopping, father has gone to work. And in the afternoon, when he's alone, he suddenly gets an idea that let us try and experiment. How does the glass breaking sound? He walks up to kitchen and he takes a piece of, nice glass. He stands table, he breaks it down, and he cuts, he gets a small cut. And he's able to somehow manage by, washing the cut and then, applying a little bit of first aid, that bandage on it. After half an hour, when mother comes, she's suddenly, seeing that, the child has got cut, and she gives some first aid treatment. Evening, they go to the doctor, they take, they take an injection. The child, feels the pain of injection. And then, he cries and the mother, pacifies the child. In the evening, when they have returned, the mother very affectionately asks, what is the reason? How did you get the cut? In the anxiety in the afternoon, she had not asked, well, how did it happen? When the child feels, very comforted and confident that, okay, I can actually share with my mom anything and everything now, he very innocently says that, I wanted to experiment how does the glass breaking sound. So I went to kitchen and I pull out a glass and I actually threw the glass onto the floor and I enjoyed it. But then just while I was stepping out, I got this small cut. When mother, hears that it was not really an accident, but it was a notorious behavior of the child. And she, when she realizes this, she gives the child a nice slap. Another set of events which simultaneously happened, that when they were going to hospital, they paid 350, 400 rupees to the cab driver. And that cab driver, while returning home in the evening, he buys himself a drink and goes back home and maybe beats somebody in the family, the wife or the child. Now you can see this entire thing happened in the afternoon and before end of the day. And we can see the cause-effect relationship here very clearly. One thing leading to another thing, that leading to another thing, that leading to another thing, and that leading to another thing. And we can also see that there is a nice crisscross. There is a nice crisscross. A child getting an idea to experiment with glass sound, and that resulting in a cab driver's wife getting beaten up. You will not really correlate in all the, senses, but then there is a correlation. Now, this happened, this entire series of events happened in the course of 5-6 hours. But imagine, just elongate this entire thing and take the case to the next level. And what we have to understand is that the boy getting thought and then, converting to action and then, experimenting with it. So basically, it is, what we can say, it is the image on your screen now is representation of how cause-effect patterns actually work. Cause-effect relations actually work. So intent, thought, action, words and the act, and they convert to result. And this may have happened in the previous incident during 5-6 hours from afternoon to end of the day. But the same thing may happen in another situation over one lifetime, another lifetime, and the third lifetime, and the fourth lifetime, and maybe 10th lifetime. Now, when things become so, so elongated, when they are beyond the scope of scientific measurement, When they're beyond the scope of scientific measurement, you know, I mean, we have limited facilities or limited tools available in scientific, you know, we can observe, we can hear, we can touch, we can, so we have five senses available, but certain things which is beyond the scope of being measured, both in terms of time and in terms of tools, then what do we do? And perhaps, you know, I mean, just a side point I'm adding here is that once people understand that there is a cause-effect relationship between the corrupt behavior, maybe even this can correct the administrative system in our country, you know, because corrupt behavior may result in bad consequence, maybe towards the end of life, towards next life, towards next life. So maybe just a side point. Point here is that limitations of science are seen in a number of ways. I mean, on the front end, the science itself may never accept it, but on the behind the doors, they also know that I mean, if you look at this this sequence of cause effect relationship, you know, we may have reason for why did the boy get cut? Why should he, you know, administer an injection? But what is the source of intent? What is the source of intent? What is the source of thought? I mean, everything that, you know, I mean, suppose there is a coffee cup on your table. Somebody brought it, right? If there is a coffee inside, somebody processed the coffee beans, and that is how you had coffee in your kitchen. Somebody processed sugar in a factory, and that is how you had sugar in your kitchen. So, you know, everything that we see comes from somewhere. So that is true for all the physical, physical things and materials and objects. But it is true also for the intent and thought. You know, I mean, it comes from somewhere. It comes from somewhere, right? I mean, the same message about this particular talk maybe was circulated and 1,000 people saw it, but maybe from those 1,000 people, 50, 100 people are seeing it now. Point is that some people didn't get the thought that I should be attending this session. So intent or thought, you know, which is basically a very, very perpetual thing continuously happening in our mind, comes from somewhere. Does the science have any explanation for it? Big question mark, really. Like I was saying a couple of minutes ago, how will science map or measure if there is any gap between the cause-effect relationship, say, you know, 100 years from now, 500 years from now, 1,000 years from now, and it is abstract in nature, right? So the effect part, one, it has gone beyond the scope of measurement in terms of time, two, in terms of tool, and three, in terms of the things that we measure. You know, I mean, we don't measure intent. We don't measure, I mean, we can measure the weight of a person, height of a person, but can we measure the intent of a person? It's a very difficult thing. That is the limitation of science. So everything cannot be really put into the framework of science as such. And that is where the next point is that, you know, the excessive biased dependency on so-called science that relies only on physical empirical proof can never be used effectively for explaining an abstract phenomena. And this is where the intuitive acceptance, you know, I was discussing about the verbal knowledge, verbalized knowledge, and intuitive knowledge. And that is where the intuitive knowledge and experiential, wisdom, right, is relevant. So not everything can be put into the framework of science, but then we have some hope that if we are intelligent enough, then we will be able to come on same page if we use our intuitive awareness. Talking about the Abrahamics, accepting or rejecting the reincarnation, I will display on the screen certain work, well-researched, well-documented books by those who are not really Brahmics as such, you know, those are not Sanatanis as such. And to begin with, you have the work of Brian Weiss. I have five books written by him on the screen. Then you can go on taking a look yourself. there are a couple who were originally from Mumbai and now they moved to Canada. Two of their sons who died in a car accident, departed soul, then started connecting with their parents. So this is the story of, that parent who were getting the inter-life messages and lessons from the two sons who had just left the world out of accident. Journey of souls. I think this could be where the reincarnation and biology intersect. I've not yet read it. But then you see, this is the range of work, which is in a silent way, presented by the people who are brought up with Abrahamic values, Abrahamic values. And they are also in a silent way, accepting that there is something which is beyond our explanation, given by our own values and our own religions. And of course, we have Kathopanishad in our Sanatan, but then that is our work. I would like to ask three, by the way, questions before we, to build up the next point. How does the soul develop? Right? Now, the soul itself may be a very abstract concept. And not that the Abrahamics don't accept it. They very much accept it. They do talk about soul in a slightly different way. But the soul develops by coming back to this life again and again, just as we go to school year after year. So each academic year takes us to the next level. So same is case with the soul development. Each life and the situations and hardships and experiences that we go through within one life, having gone through it, and if we reflect upon it properly and pick up the lessons involved in it, that takes us to the next higher level of growth of the soul. Soul is the bedrock on which the characteristics, as we are, born with, are imprinted, are impressioned. And that comes from the experiences of life. So it is very important to understand that soul development happens through experiences of life. And that takes us to the next question is, what is meant by soul development altogether? Right? So I have given a hint in the previous response itself that developing the personal qualities, like empathy, like patience, enterprise, integrity, so on and so forth. There is a corrupt government official, but perhaps one incident in his life will happen which will give him which will show him mirror that being corrupt is not the right thing to do, right? Maybe loud thinking that he accepted a bribe of 5 lakh rupee, and when he returned home the same day, he found that his father suffered a heart attack same day, and same day he had to deposit this money in hospital for the treatment. But the point here is that the officer, if he doesn't reflect upon it, he will not pick up the lesson, right? But if he reflects upon it, maybe he gets the message very silently, very silent message that because you accepted money that didn't really belong to you, it actually belonged to the doctor. So your father had to undergo this heart attack in order to let that money get channeled towards the doctor. Now, this kind of realization may put that officer in right track. And from that day, he will learn the lesson of integrity. So this is how the experiences of life, if we couple it up with reflecting upon it, picking up the right lessons from it, that is how the soul develops, right? And I have some treat for you on the right side, some rasgullas. But the point here is that, the very idea of Abrahamics calling itself religion without really discussing about the development of soul, can it really be called religion altogether? A religion ideally is a framework which should facilitate the growth of the person, the internal growth of a person. And if soul development is in not their agenda, they don't really have a very defined framework for soul development. As a matter of fact, one step further, they reject the idea of soul development through multiple lives and reincarnation. Is it worth calling it a religion altogether? Can we call Rasgulla without sugar syrup or Rasgulla at all? So that is the point that I'm trying to, you know, I mean, bring through through this illustration. That gets us to the Abrahamic intent, the question of Abrahamic intent, actually. You know, it is self-evident and progressively self-evident that the Abrahamics is becoming or proving itself empirically be proven as a land grab system, or a system which is all out for cultural wipeout. How does it work? We know, there is a systematic decade-long project they have. They plant church, they will plant schools, they will have gangs going around doing the conversion. And for all this, there is a huge internal international lobbying system. They have a legal framework system. They are even using the international protocols like that of United Nations and human rights and so on and so forth. On the other hand, you have one particular class of people enters to another country as a refugee, and then it claims the human rights there, and then on the face of human rights they almost settle down there. After settling down, they have decade after decade process of increasing population, and then they would like to become a substantial voice in the democratic process. And after they have this, they would like to demand for Sharia, and that Sharia allows for the killing of kafirs. So there is a very definite pattern which we can see. And it can be actually established even through research, so to say. Point here is that the next point is very, very important, that if you look at these frameworks, which is which is being implemented for decades altogether, maybe for centuries altogether, what you will find missing is that soul development is nowhere in their agenda. Of both the Abrahamics as such, Abrahamic ideas, Abrahamic thought processes. Hence, that is why they almost reject the idea of incarnation, reincarnation, because it doesn't fit their agenda. Reincarnation, that is why, is not in their radar as such. So having correlated with the intent and their response to the idea of reincarnation, can we now say that it is the rejection of reincarnation, is it a convenient refusal? Is it a convenient refusal because it will give them inconvenience if they accept it? This is a thought process which I'm giving, and that is where I'm now slowly coming to the idea of two separate worlds, the title of the book which I have given. That, the title of this talk, that mainstream acceptance of reincarnation, how is it going to affect the Abrahamic religion? I want to say that mainstream acceptance is already there. In one society, it is already there. And mainstream refusal is already there in the other society. There are two separate worlds. One, the mainstream is acceptance of reincarnation. The other world, mainstream, is rejection of reincarnation. And, if you look at the human society in general, we are both wise and unwise. We are both wise and unwise. And if you look at these two worlds that I am trying to give hint towards, one world which is accepting the reincarnation, other world which is rejecting the reincarnation. In both the worlds, you also have wise and unwise people stuck within that world. So there are wise people in Abrahamics who are accepting the idea of reincarnation, and there will be there will be examples and, you know, unique cases within Brahmic, Brahmic followers who will question, who will demand proof for reincarnation, whereas the reincarnation is the intuitive body of knowledge, right? So that is where, and this next point is, you know, I mean, let me build up slightly differently than what it is written on the text here. You know, pick up the two points here, intent and comprehension. Intent is karmic and comprehension also is karmic, right? We get the idea because of our past karmas, and we understand or don't understand something again because of our past karmas, right? So this point, I'm leaving it here. It may not, I may not really correlate with the next point as such, but point here is that intent and comprehension itself evolve through births and rebirths. So a person who is not understanding the idea of reincarnation today, even he will be born and born again and born again and born again, and one fine lifetime he will understand the idea of reincarnation, right? So that is what I'm trying to say, and that is where the last point here is that, by the way, how does it matter? If somebody did not accept that there is a gravity, how does it matter? It doesn't matter. Gravity is still there. If somebody does not accept that there is incarnation, how does it matter? Reincarnation or multiple lives and that cycle of multiple cause effect karmic web is already there. So accepting or not accepting is quite irrelevant, actually. Discussing the idea that they're not accepting, it's not really required. It's not really required. And that is where, I'd like to point out Abrahamic ideas, three design flaws. First of them is the idea of one, one prophet, one holy book. Why one? Did we go to school and learn from one teacher only, or did we have multiple teachers? Did we learn from one book only, or did we have multiple books? So the idea of one is by itself, something which makes anyone, likely to be an incomplete, likely to be misleading. the next point I have, listed some of the words that they use, that gunah and neki. I've picked up these two words from one of the videos which was circulating on Twitter, where one of the, white burqa clad lady, almost like a spiritual leader, was talking about that you must not commit gunah because it is going to cause you trouble post the life, and you must do neki. And she was talking all these terminologies, good, accepted. But, it amounts to something like this, that if they teach something, it must be taught in complete sense. It must be taught in complete sense, because half-baked cake is neither good for tummy, not good for, you can't even store it in fridge, not can you eat it. Imagine a surgeon who says that I have learned how to cut open the tummy or a stomach, but I don't know how to stitch it back. So talking about gunah and neki and the pain one will go through after he dies or she dies is, it gives you indication that they have some understanding of the cause-effect relationship. But with an intent, they are not teaching the full thing to their followers. And if they want to teach the full thing, then of course they will have to include reincarnation in the mainstream discussion that they have in their own society. And for that matter, The third point I have said that it is not just the reincarnation about which the Abrahamics are incomplete. It is also about how to coexist with the nature as part of the nature. We can go in detail about it sometime. It also doesn't really have an in-depth understanding of the socionomics as such. We can call socioeconomics. And the deep the human animal psychology, which is very much part of the Brahmic scriptures and teachings. So if we look at the Brahmic design, it lacks not only in the reincarnation as one of the component. The point I'm trying to establish is that it is not only void of reincarnation as one of the important element, but it is also missing on certain other elements which makes religion, so to say, a complete one. And that is where the Abrahamics have certain pillars that cannot really be they also have certain pillars which cannot really be proven in the physical realm. If they are really asking for proof of reincarnation, then even they are talking about Neki and Hoors and 72 Hoors and Jannat, and even those things cannot be proven on the physical realm. So we don't need to really consider reincarnation as our weak point. It's basically it's an abstract knowledge. If you look at the Abrahamics from a historical perspective, and perhaps in this morning itself you had a session on the recent history of India, most of the Abrahamic practices, they are a set of lies to cover another set of lies, and that to cover the even further older set of lies. So it is basically a history of misdeeds which is being covered through the preaching of religion, so to say. So that is where it is a little worrying that the followers are kept away from the soul development which is possible through spiritual practices or religious practices. And this is the point which I have put it in the last third point, that in the process the Abrahamics will fail its followers too, right? Abrahamic religion is failing or not failing, that is secondary thing, but there are genuine followers, there are genuine people who are stuck in the Abrahamic life. They may fail because of following a incomplete ideology. And personally, I pity the people who may be stuck, and who are being used as a subject, using the fear tactics. Actually, I will run through these slides. Maybe I'll not speak much because I want to take your questions more than myself speaking. This is the book which I wrote a few years ago, which is available, a few copies with me. It is a book which describes how to meaningfully use the life that we have. Anyway, the pattern of soul progress. This is an interesting slide, so let me spend 2 minutes in this. This is how the pattern of the soul progress looks like. And the entangled patches are the ones where we are stuck, and straight patches are the ones where we are making progress. And if you look at the circles as one life, then what you will find that there are four kinds of lives. On my left, the first on the left is the one life which was entangled and further became, it actually, instead of making progress, it made some deterioration. It learned some wrong things in the life. The second life is on the, from the left, second life is, which started as an entangled life, but through life experiences, through a series of reflections and mentoring that he or she received, he or she actually made good progress. So after entanglement, you can see a graph which goes up. The third life from my left, the third life is the one which remained entangled. And the fourth life is the one which made very, very fast progress, very, very fast progress. So this is how, if I have to present the reincarnations in a pictorial manner, you know, in an illustrative, in an illustration, perhaps this will, you know, I mean, this will partly serve as a kind of illustration, if not proof. I'll quickly display this. I'll not read it out because it's going to take a long time. Two columns. One, suggestions for the people who are born in Abrahamics. And on the right, we have certain tips for the people who are born in Brahmics religion. Take a note of the point that you'd like to, you know, I mean, relate with, to ask a question. Before closing, I'd like to give the typology of disagreement also, because the disagreement is something which we have to keep handling time and again when we, you know, indulge in subjects like reincarnation, complex and abstract. One is a developmental disagreement, where the two sides agree that this is what we need to do together. You know, so that is, I mean, disagree on what needs to be developed. So that is developmental disagreement, when two sides don't come on same page on what needs to be developed. Second is functional disagreement, which is the situation when two sides don't agree on how to part, you know, I mean, how to, you know, I mean, how to do a thing, how to perform a task, how to do a project and things like that. Third is what we can call vicious disagreement, you know, typical neighborhood fights, you know, ending nowhere, starting nowhere. And, you know, at any point of time, if you try to figure out what is happening, what is wrong there, you will not be able to come to a conclusion. And fourth is what we can call confrontational disagreement, where one side is all out to, you know, I mean, kind of sabotage or, you know, I mean, you know, destroy the other side. So if you look at these four kinds of disagreements, what I would like to say is that a Brahmic mind is naturally inclined for, because we accept the idea of development, inner growth, reincarnation, multiple lives, cause-effect relationships, and also because you can see that, you know, through the pattern of millennia of our growth. So from that, I would like to say that because the Brahmic mind is naturally inclined for and designed for developmental and functional disagreements, means which we, what I mean is that we disagree that what needs to be developed, and then we figure it out how to develop, and then, you know, I mean, that agreement and disagreement is a part of our growth process. I mean, I think I should also put functional disagreements and agreements. So because the Brahmic mind is, you know, conditioned and designed for, you know, developmental and functional disagreements and agreements, we keep making progress. We keep making progress. And that is where it is quite likely that it is a Brahmic person who will, if at all it has to happen, bring a reform in Abrahamic religions or the ideas, right? And this, you know, evolving and correction, I mean, the question there is that are the Abrahamic religions at all having the idea of evolving themselves, correcting themselves? That itself is a big question mark. That itself is a big question mark. But if at all it has to happen, perhaps it will be bound from a person or a group which is not part of the Abrahamic ideology. Final takes. This is last two slides. I'll be quick. Not to expect, I think the points are quite self-explanatory. Not to expect complete verbalization about the reincarnation, because it's intuitive knowledge. If intuition is difficult, then one can use imagination. Suppose if I have to explain what is postcard to a child who is born in year 2005, who has never seen a postcard, and if I don't get a postcard, you know, then I'll have to help him to imagine. Maybe I will take a piece of paper, I will actually, you know, I mean, cut it into a postcard size, I'll draw it like a postcard, and then help him to imagine the postcard. So maybe if they cannot get the idea of intuitive knowledge, then maybe imagination can help there. There always is something unknown to the individual and unknown to everybody. Even at this point of time, when we are talking so much about Brahmics being intelligent, being you know, intuitive, being development oriented, maybe there are things which even we don't know. right? So there are things, there is always something which is unknown. So we have to keep our mind open for that, unknown to the individual and unknown to everybody. And I think this is the point I would like to make with stress. In fact, this is antithesis. Why I wish reincarnation is not really a mainstream accepted idea. Because whatever is accepted in the mainstream, science, physics, medicine, biology, most of the things, I mean, though it has been used for good cause, but it has been also been used for with a bad intent by people with bad intent. So if the reincarnation is accepted in mainstream, it may happen that there is a court case, and in his defense, the person says that I cheated this person because in three lives ago he actually owed it to me. You know, so people may misuse the idea of reincarnation, and as such, the legal system is is very effective, very prompt. It will become even more prompt. So it will be actually abused more. So I wish that two separate worlds remain. One which accepts normally that reincarnation is there, and the other world, we can't really help them. From that world, who are open-minded and progressive and development-oriented, they are welcome to this world. Final slide that says that soul incarnation, soul development is not their currency. Brahmic response to the economic and political design of Abrahamics is still not in place. And longing to evolve is the basic character of soul, and that soul is there even in those people who are currently caught or trapped within Abrahamic religions. So even some of them are yearning for developing further, right? Developing further, and perhaps sooner or later, they'll be born again, or by reflection, they will come to us on same page that yes, reincarnation is there. And finally, both Brahmics as well as Abrahamics, those who are going through the internal conflict, the pain of the soul, as they call it, the painful, when there is something painful, but you are not really able to articulate it properly. When there is something calling you, there is something, as if you are looking for something. In such situations, both Abrahamics as well as Brahmics will benefit from the psycho-karmic healing. I'd like to take your questions, please. I am through with my presentation. Those of you who'd like to follow me, here is my Twitter handle.
Sir, I have one question. We have two types, like intellectual and conscious man. The intellectual believes that what is in our mind is only our life. And what the conscious person believes that we are an energy and we are always changed. This energy always changes from one place to another, travels, and it always shifts. Which will be better? That conscious will be better or intellectual will be better? And my small question is that we have seen some of the facts, like some of the cases where people knows that, okay, this was my past life, I remember it, and actually it's there. So what's your view on it?
Talking about two minds that you mentioned, the intellectual mind and the consciousness, and the, it is definitely there. All that gut feeling and the sixth sense, and the natural responses that come from come from us without really much thinking, they fall under the category of conscious mind. I'll put it this way in simple words, that when we are operating out of our natural qualities, natural characteristics, then we are operating through our conscious mind. Right? And intellectual mind, the logical mind, the rational mind is more or less academic in nature. And at times it helps, and at times it actually unhelps. So that is my take about the conscious mind and the intellectual mind. And we have to use both, and we have to train ourselves to use both. Both have specific utilization, you can say so. specific condition where a condition where intellectual mind is more functional or useful, another situation when the conscious mind is more, right? If we put little effort, we can definitely recall something, right? I mean, suppose 3 years ago you had gone to Delhi and maybe you spent 3 days there. Today, if you recall, maybe you will remember only the purpose. I had gone to Delhi to give interview and I got selected in that interview. But if you put little more effort, you will remember that which hotel I stayed in, what did I eat, how much did I pay to the cab driver, what did the receptionist tell me. You will remember every detail, right? If you apply little memory. But then what is the use of it? So same is case with past life memories. We may have a lot of things in our storeroom, right? We may have a lot of things in our storeroom, but we work with the things which we need today. So don't worry too much about past lives and future lives. Both are there, past lives as well as future lives, right? So I think we should not fret too much about it. That's what my take is. We should be more pragmatic. We should be more down to earth. But yes, we should keep reflecting upon the experiences and try to develop ourselves, take our responses to the next orbit of response.
Actually, I didn't have a question, but I had an incident to narrate, which happened to me years ago. It so happened that my father passed away. The year was 2006. And of course, I was being the only child, I was very attached to him. So I clearly remember, I think within a period of 15 or maybe 20 days at the most, he appeared in my dream and he asked me not to worry about him. And he told me that he has now been born in an ex country and in an ex family. So this is how he narrated this to me. And I very clearly remember those words still, are etched in my memory, how he spoke and how I saw him. And I didn't have the means to investigate. I mean, if I had to, even though I tried to write an email to that country, and it was actually a Sikh family which he had mentioned. And he mentioned that the country was Japan. So I assume in Japan, not many Sikhs would have been.
Few Sikhs will be there.
Yes. Yeah. So I wrote to the Sikh Gurudwara committee, probably over there in Tokyo. And I sent a couple of reminders. Unfortunately, nothing came back. And so this is what I wanted to share. So, it would have
interesting,
been
interesting. What you shared is something very, very normal. This is the beauty of our conditioning and our culture, that we very naturally, gracefully, respectfully accept these kind of inputs. These kind of inputs. And what happened with you and what happened with your father is something. Yes, this is how it happens. And this is not only one way. There are so many ways the soul makes progress after it leaves this body. Some could come within 15 days. Some could take rest for 6 months. Some could take rest for 10 years, right? And the time framework that I'm using, 15 days or 6 months or 10 years, it is not the same in the cosmic world. Their time doesn't get measured in years and weeks, and they don't have time as such, the way we know it.
Hey, just add on something to what you said.
Yes, please.
I have read this book by Mary T. Brown, which she says that normally what people, in fact, I think Brian Wise also says it someplace, that some lady saw her deceased mother sitting on her porch, enjoying a coffee, looking at her garden. And he said, and somebody met Jesus after death. So she said the conditioning that you have had during your life is usually your experience after death. You may meet Krishna or you may meet Jesus according to your strong beliefs during the life.
What you said and what you said just now, if I have to put my perspective, one line I would like to say is that, Dr. Brian Weiss has written 5 books or maybe more than that, for example, but he does not really openly accept that there is a lot of information already available on multiple lives in a simple book like Kathopanishad, right? And I attribute it to he being born and he not having access to Kathopanishad altogether. So I think we have to go away. You know, I mean, there is a limited we can learn in one lifetime, and there is a limited we can make progress in one lifetime. And it's just like that. In 1 year, we can pass only second grade. In 1 year, we can only pass third grade. So I think we have to live with it.
I like the concepts that you talked about. A fantastic talk. I really enjoyed it. One is you talked about convenient refusal. And so it is not just about convenient refusal. The West also does the convenient acceptance. Like karma, they have accepted that, okay, karma is there, but they have fitted it within the same lifetime. Yeah, if you do something bad today, you'll be punished. But the whole concept, dharmic concept, is not about you getting the reward or the punishment in this lifetime. And it doesn't have to be reward and punishment. So do you think they don't want to accept it because, one, it will shake the roots of Abrahamic faith, and two, because it contradicts, because they have this linear timing. And the moment you accept the cyclic timing, the moment you accept reincarnation, you have to accept cyclic timing. So do you think that is the reason why they are not accepting?
Absolutely. I did cover that, you know, because it doesn't fit their agenda of, you know, I mean, that political economic agenda. And because of that, they wouldn't accept it. Because if they start teaching complete science of karma, or the complete, complete awareness about karma as a complete concept. I did talk about that they teach half things and they don't teach the other half thing. So it's half-baked knowledge that they are serving, and that is what is very dangerous. So I completely agree with you, and it is really a case of, you added convenient acceptance. I had given the perspective of convenient rejection. So it is both happening there. You know, they're accepting karma, manipulating it to their design, and they're refusing the other part of karma, which is the reincarnation, because, you know, it cannot complete without, you know, coming back.
Yeah. The pencil example that you gave, such a simple but such a thought-provoking example, that sometimes when you present even the plethora of proofs, people still want you to prove it. However, it is so convenient for West that they want rest of the world to believe that a man saw apple falling from the tree and discovered the law of gravity. So do you think that it is time that the world should actually put West on the same pedestal and say that they refuse the whole idea of law, principles? You have to prove it, and you have to show you the source of it for the rest of the world to believe it.
You know, I mean, my take about we must put the West on pedestal, and, you know, we must prove to them, I think it is going to happen much more organically, much more gradually than suddenly one fine morning a conference happening and one side and the other side. And no, it's not going to happen that way. You know, it's permeated very, very deep into the system. And you know, I mean, they have worked hard for more than 2000 years to peddle the idea that they are peddling, you know, and they're doing it very systematically, in a very aggressive and organized manner, with you know, resource rich plan to back them up. And I think what we need to learn maybe is some of the tactics that they are using, I mean, to put it in a different perspective altogether. So it will happen. And I think we have started seeing it happening also. I mean, altogether there are quite a few Abrahamics who are now openly coming and appreciating
Tariq Fateh,
for example. You know, these are people who are, you know, very, very developed soul. You know, I mean, though they are trapped in Abrahamic ideology, but their soul is very, very developed. Their soul is very, very developed. So this is what I mean, that it will happen organically. It will not happen through a conference. This will not happen through one book, which will, you know, smash up everything. It is a work of 2000 plus years that they have, you know, pursued. And you have seen the map, which I showed, you know, the Abrahamic map is almost 160 plus countries today. So we are in a situation where ultimately we have to persist, and we have to believe that truth will prevail.
So I have a very simple question. Sir, you mentioned that whatever deeds or misdeeds or maybe intentions or thoughts which we commit in a particular life, we get the result of the same in the upcoming life sometimes. So, sir, what are your thoughts upon maybe the concept of heaven and heaven or hell? As in, don't we get the result of our karmas once we are dead, and whether we go to either hell or heaven to reap the results for the same?
I understand. Two points, Shruti. Number one, there is nothing called heaven or hell as such. You know, I mean, I don't really buy the idea of heaven and hell. There is a definite process between two lives. And within two lives, there are six processes or six phases that we may go through. Some of us may go through all six. Some of us may go through three of them and skip other three, and then, So I have spoken about those processes which happen between this birth and the next birth in one of my talk for Health Library of Mumbai. The YouTube link is available. Coming to your question that whether we get punishment or not, not really. You see, there are certain misdeeds, but if we reflect upon it and take a lesson out of it, then misdeed is forgiven. So the life and the interlife both are not too bad as such. You know, if we go on picking up lessons, if we go on reflecting about upon whatever is happening with us through all the life experiences and through our default responses.
So my second question is, so if we have committed certain karmas and we are getting the results in the upcoming lives, if we don't realize it in the given life, so will that actually determine or plays a role in what way we are taking birth? Or maybe in what country or what religion, what caste or what creed we are taking birth in? Or maybe we are taking birth as an Ekendriya Jeev or as an animals. Will that also be a result of the same?
I'll give you an example. And this example, I'll quote one example from Brian Weiss' life, and maybe I'll give one personal example. Brian Weiss, in his books, one of his books, he gives example of one lady who had exceptionally beautiful, slim, long hands, you know, exceptionally good, struck, very nice, long hands. And when she was regressed, what the doctor found, or what she herself found, is that she was a couple of lives ago, she was in some village in maybe some tribal place and forest area where there was a temple, and she was she used to volunteer and do the cleaning for that temple every day for maybe years together. So she used to go and sweep and mop and maintain that temple for many, many years in her previous life. So as a reward for her good work, her hands became beautiful. Right? This is one example. Another example I'll give you with myself. Maybe I work with 10 or 15% eyesight. The reason if I go regress myself, I'll find that maybe 10 births ago, I had misused my eyes for something which was unethical or immoral. I'm not giving example right now, but maybe because of that, I was punished that you have to now work with very little vision. Now, not that we are punishing you with blindness, but we are giving you some vision so that you realize the value for it. And believe me, with 10% eyesight in last 15 years, I would have read not less than 300 books. And I have written around half a dozen books so far, and half a dozen other books are in pipeline. So I'm making the best use of my eyesight, giving it the respect and the value that it deserves, right? So this is how the karma plays. Karma plays in a number of very fascinating ways. In my YouTube talk, I have given at least 3-4 more other stories, you know.
Arvindji, it was a wonderful talk, and very few people, you know, really come out and openly talk on this subject. They're so scared and shy of doing this. I just want to make one small point. I would like to have your comments on it. One,
sure.
See, in our scriptures, like say Bhagavat and all that, there are so many instances of reincarnation, not just one or two.
Yes, absolutely.
So that is probably one of the reasons why we accept reincarnation as a, you know, as a routine. We don't even question it. Even in Bible, from what we heard, some rabbis talk, there was a prophet called Elijah. He's supposed to have been reborn as John. So when discussions are going on regarding this reincarnation, so this is quoted. But even not any of the Jews say, yes, reincarnation, at least 10 to 15% of their followers believe in reincarnation. And this is given as an example. But they also rationalize and say that this gentleman prophet Elijah was an exception. He became the John, but it is not applicable to normal other human beings. And resurrection of Christ on the third day is also an exception. It is not admissible for anybody else. This is one thing I heard again and again from these people.
Thank you. Yes, Kansab, I think, again, I have not read you know, those versions of the scriptures which you mentioned. I have not heard any talk as such. So, like I said in my talk, not accepting reincarnation, not accepting that the longing of the soul that it would like to, you know, evolve perpetually, it is a convenient rejection that, you know, I mean, they are into, because they are using religion, so to say, for a very different purpose altogether, and that I have said very specifically in one of the slides, for land grab and for manipulating the cultures all over the world, and because it doesn't fit their agenda, so that is why they are they're conveniently snubbing the idea of masses getting enlightened or being aware about the reincarnation as a process. Also, picking up from your narration only, I'm making this comment that, you know, if you look at the distinction between Brahmics and Abrahamics, we don't differentiate necessarily between the God and the follower as such. You know, I mean, for us, the follower also has all the elements of God. He's the one who is, you know, evolving gradually towards godhood. But if they are making a distinction between few and the masses, then they are actually creating a mechanism by which the masses are, you know, I mean, deprived of the growth, the development, which is unfortunate, which is what I have pointed out in one of the slides, that it is a religion which will fail by itself as a religion, so to say, also will fail its followers sooner or later. And that is where, you know, there are many Abrahamic souls who are actually evolved, and now they are, questioning. Now they are questioning. So it's an organic process. It's an organic process. And that is how I think, you know, I mean, in a natural way, things will start falling in place. Thank you.
Why are countries with predominantly Abrahamic foundations considered, which are also considered developed countries, whereas more Brahmic countries or civilizations are in turmoil, both internal and external in comparison? This allows the Abrahamic concept to be given more prominence in lieu of their dominance, both socially and geopolitically.
Mohitji, can I ask this question in response to your question? Is every wealthy person a happy person? Not really, right? See, development of the world, you know, for the countries which are Abrahamic, and, you know, the definition of development, right? That is what we need to look at. So the development, if you go to Wikipedia and search for social development index, or some parameters like that. So, you know, the development itself is being defined more or less in terms of the physical realities, you know, income per capita, education level, and now they have added few things like, you know, I mean, gender equality and so on and so forth. So they keep coming up with those terminologies. They keep, collecting empirical data and, creating a narrative to make one side look developed. Okay, having a car doesn't make them developed. And that is where, the second definition of development, right? Second development of definition, which is in terms of, which is in terms of happiness index, and maybe in terms of if you do a very unbiased research as to which faith or which belief system has contributed to the world most, if you go back historically, right from architecture to medicine to science to we have given much more to the world already. It is just that, last 2000 years has been bad, we have our history as well as our memory where we can recall only so much, right? Most of the literature which is available both in formal education and in non-formal circles talks only about these last 2000 years. So that is where we are feeling, perturbed. But then I hope and I wish and I feel that, things start moving to the other direction. And rest, we may or may not be able to see in our lifetime, but let's see. I think I'm too small to comment what will happen, 50 years down the line, 200 years down the line, and how will it happen? Right? I'm too small to say anything about it.
So I was listening to this lecture by Dr. Raj Vedam, where he talked about this fantastic concept, and he said that when you think about Atma, don't compare it with soul. Because the moment you say soul, people think Jashoda would have a soul, Arvindji would have a soul. That is not the concept. That because when you say Atma, it's a bunch of Paramatma which is in you. What is Paramatma? Paramatma is Brahma. What is Brahma? Brahma is cosmos. And he talked about this very nice concept. He said that a group of scientists, which includes few Indian and Western scientists, who have found that even the cosmos retains memory. So when a cosmos is created, dissolves, and again gets recreated, which is a cyclic timing, it says that the cosmos also retains some memories. So now, because this team is working on it, should we be hopeful that once this is proven, then it explains the whole concept of, Atma, Paramatma, recreation? Because if the cosmos retains the memory, then why is it so beyond our imagination that within the same lifetime, between lifetime, a memory from one body travels to the other body? So your thoughts on that?
Interesting points you have brought up, and two-point response. Number one, about we, the small-brained men and women, trying to, map or prove something about cosmos is like, an ant trying to, lift your laptop, So it's almost impossible thing. It's an almost impossible thing. How much ever we talk about cosmos, we will continue to find a point again and again. Maybe it will continue to grow higher and higher, but then we will continue to find a point where we become helpless. Because the cosmos itself is growing, whom are you trying to compete with? Cosmos. It's an impossible thing for us to, ever compete about it. our finger cannot lift us, our finger cannot lift us. So we are just a part of cosmos. Coming to the second part of my response is that the cosmos memory exchange happening, suppose one soul leaves this body and is born again, do you think only, suppose one Mr. XYZ Kumar leaves the body, will he carry only the soul of XYZ Kumar? No. In the interlife, maybe XYZ Kumar will get mixed up with one Mr. MS, and then his ex will be dropped, and it will be, mixed up with Mr. ABC. And so much, mingling of, splitting of a soul and then mixing of soul and, restructuring of soul will happen. And that will keep mixing the memories with each other and, new personalities, new characters being born again and again and again and again. So that is what is my take about the change and interchange and memory and memories. I mean, that is how it happens. So interlife process is very fascinating. I have discussed about it in my YouTube talk, in the health library talk separately.
So far, all the work that has been done in this field, from whatever I have read, has been by and large empirical studies, listing out, say, even by Ian Stevenson or Jim Tucker. And there doesn't seem to be a medical explanation to reincarnation from Western psychology, from whatever we have seen. They're still trying to wrap their heads around the whole and they're only going by numbers, of locating these cases of reincarnation.
Yes.
World.
Correct.
Is there, I'm we have the, with increasing acceptance of Indic psychology from our knowledge body, Sankhya and yoga, and increasing acceptance of those studies and increasing research being carried out there. Could we be trying to explain reincarnation through that, body of knowledge, like say at the koshas, the panchakoshas, the trigunas, the cosmic body of smriti that is there, said that, the cosmos holds a smriti and it's only a matter of accessing that smriti. It is, there are times when you are able to foresee what is going to happen in the future or recall what happened to somebody else. At least our seers were able to do that, our rishis and people like that.
Yes.
They were accessing the cosmic memory, which was not necessarily their smriti, right? So I'm wondering if the Indic researchers or, researchers in the field of Indic psychology should try to explain reincarnation. Is that even an attempt that is worthwhile? You think we should be doing?
Like I said, Sumati ji, in my talk, the reincarnation is not a domain of verbalized knowledge. I think second or third slide itself, I said that when I gave the typology of knowledge, that there is one knowledge which is verbalized knowledge, how does the water boil? We can actually explain through the heat processes, but reincarnation is under intuitive knowledge category. It can never be verbalized, and the efforts to put it under empirical system, the empirical research and numbers and cases, and that will never succeed as such. They will never succeed, and any attempts by us to convince them or to, prove it to them will be more and more received as our own weakness, they're trying to convince us. Why should we try to convince them? Those who know, they know. And those who don't know, I think let them be born again and evolve through their, through their karmas till the life when they have an open mind to accept and, move further. So by convincing, no, we should not try to convince them. It has to be a life experience by which a person reflects and opens his own mind, her own mind, and then takes it further thereon. So I don't think we should fall trap of trying to, put together, a discourse or a body of knowledge or a literature. Of course, we should evolve our own knowledge. We should keep writing. We should keep doing our own conferences. We should keep doing our own discussions, but not with an intent to convince them. Our intent has to be documenting it further. For example, I wrote one Upanishad in year 2020. If you look at the idea of Upanishad, it is something which was written in year 5,000 years ago, 10,000 years ago. But I wrote one Upanishad about handling your life's prosperity and your profession and business in year 2020. So we, Brahmical, as a Brahmic religion, we must keep evolving ourselves, even in the area of reincarnation understanding. That is a different thing altogether. But that is our own homework, our own evolution, not to convince the other party. That is my take about it, Sumati ji.
I am introduced to a new topic. I'm very old, but still I want to ask you one question. Will extensive knowledge of this concept of reincarnation, will it cause a fear in the heart at the time of decision making and execution? I say again my last two words. At the time of decision making,
I get the point.
I hope the host allows the time.
I got your question, sir. And on a happy note, I would like to say that it is just the reverse. Once we know the entire process and how satisfying, how evolutionary, how developmental, and how full of opportunity it is, we actually feel at very comfort level with our own self. It is just the reverse. And for that matter, very systematic body of knowledge is already available. If you would like to read something small, then I would recommend Katha Upanishad. It's a very simple reading. It is available from most of the spiritual organizations. And I'll try and put a link, Katha Upanishad version, which I read, I think it was from Vipassana or somewhere. I don't remember, but I have read one publication from one of the spiritual organization, and it is available. And I'm sure it is available from Gita Press also, in both English, Hindi, and many other languages. It's a beautiful, very organized presentation of the knowledge of the life process. I'm saying life process because, you know, the Katha Upanishad is based on Janaka's son's question, when he said that, when he asked Yamaraj that what happens to me after I'm with you on top, and the processes that is explained, it is mesmerizing. It is very, very, uplifting. It's very uplifting. And I have given some clue in my YouTube talk also.